Good morning, students. Welcome back to the gate class on analog circuits. So in last class itself, we started with the introduction of analog circuits, where we were discussing about the introduction of op-amp, about the evolution of integrated circuits, and then we discussed about the characteristics of op-amp, like ideal characteristics, and then how op-amp can be used as an amplifier, right? An inverting amplifier, non-inverting amplifier. And then we started with the applications of op-amp also last class itself. Like, we discussed few applications like adder, in that inverting adder, non-inverting adder, and then differential amplifier, and then we discussed differentiator, integrator. So we started discussing applications of op-amp, and we are going to continue that in today's class also. Basic problems we discussed in the last class, and today also we'll be continuing with applications of op-amp theory part, I mean the concept behind it, and then we'll be moving on with the problems. So let us start with today's class. The last topic what we started in previous class was about integrator and differentiator. Okay, just we'll refresh this and go for the problem, because we didn't see any problem in last class. So now we are going to see problems based on this differentiator and integrator. So we'll just brush up with what we discussed here in this topic, and then we'll move on with the problem, right? And an integrator. So this is what this integrator circuit. Right. If you see this integrator circuit, it is similar to an inverting amplifier, except that you have a capacitor in the feedback. For an inverting amplifier, we'll be having a resistor here in the feedback. Now we have a capacitor here, right? So that is the only difference. And this capacitor only will store your charge. It will charge and discharge. So based on that only, the circuit is going to act as an integrator. Integrator means basically it is, we can call this as a low pass filter. Low frequencies will be allowed in this. And differentiator, we can call it as a high pass filter, right? So this can be used as a low pass filter also. So as usual, how will you try to get the output expression for a circuit? We always use the golden rules of op-amp, is it not? That is what we discussed. So that is, whenever one terminal is grounded, it means the other terminal also will be maintaining the same ground potential. That is, we call it as virtual ground, is it not? So since this non-inverting terminal is grounded, this will also be at zero potential. So when you try to write the nodal equation for this node, okay, we'll be having an expression in terms of input and output. So rearrange that to get an expression for output, and which is P naught is equal to minus 1 by R1C. R1C is your time constant of this integrator circuit. Integral VSDL. If the capacitor, see, this expression holds good when you have discharged your capacitor completely and then starting with the started giving the input, right? But if you have some charge already stored in the capacitor, a pre-charge, an initial charge is there in the capacitor, means we'll have a slight change in the expression. So in that case, you'll have that initial charge what you have in the capacitor first, and then Vx minus 1 by R1C integral VSDT. So remember this we didn't see in last class. That's why I'm insisting on this. We are going to do problem where the initial charge will be given. Okay. So whenever the capacitor has some initial charge, then the expression changes in this way. Okay. So this will be a final expression for integrator. And next one is applications of integrator. Application of integrator is, we have a ramp generator which can be generated using an integrator circuit. So basically we can use this as a waveform generator, right? So when you give a constant voltage to the integrator, then the output will be a ramp generator. Like, when I give this constant voltage to the integrator circuit, the output will be a ramp like this, right? The same concept, I'm just changing like this. Instead of a single constant voltage, I'm going to jump between two voltages. Okay, so a positive constant and then a negative constant, then a positive constant, so which is nothing but a square wave. So So when I give a square wave here as the input, then the output will be a triangular wave like this, okay, an inverter triangular wave. So you that and all we can change, okay, all these things. If you want this to be a positive triangle, that also we can make change in the circuit. The polarity, if we reverse, we will get it, right? So we can use this integrator as a waveform generator, right? And other than this, you have other applications. As I said, triangular wave generator, you can use it as a ramp generator. And in A to D converters, okay, we'll be comparing with the ramp, and then only we'll be converting an analog signal into a digital signal in a single slope ADC, dual slope ADC, and also there and all we'll be using this to solve differential equations, right? So we need integrator there, mathematical integration, is it not? So that there we'll be going on with this integrator circuit. As I said, you can use this as a low pass filter also. So these are the major applications of an integrator. And now this is what I said, we are going to see some problem based on this integrator. So first we'll see the circuit. So first, when you see the circuit itself, easily you can identify this as an integrator circuit because you have a capacitor in the feedback path, right? Now what is given in the question? The integrator circuit has an initial voltage of minus 1.4 volts, right? This is what we were discussing in the previous slide. You will be having an initial voltage in the sense the capacitor will have an initial stored charge. So the value of that charge is minus 1.4 volts. So the initial voltage in the capacitor is minus 1.4 volts across the capacitor at time t is equal to 0. A step input voltage Vs equal to minus 2 volts is applied at time t is equal to 0. So it means I'm going to apply an input voltage of minus 2 volts here. This is, you have an initial charge. Here I'm applying the input. Determine the RC time constant necessary such that the output voltage reaches 10.2 volts at time t is equal to 5. See, they have given the input, output, initial charge in the capacitor, at what time all these operations are carried out. Everything has been given. The only thing what we need to find out here is the time constant. Okay, so how to do this problem? How we should proceed with the problem? So as of now, if you see, we have seen only one expression for the integrator, that is the output expression, is it not? V naught equal to Vx minus 1 by R1C integral Vs dt, right? So that is what we saw now. So you have to use the same equation. All the required data have been given here. Just try to substitute that in that expression and get an output for it. So please make a try. Once you have completed, I'll show you the solution for this. Initial voltage is given as minus 1.4 volts. So in that expression, substitute Vx to be minus 1.4. Input is given, which is minus 2 volts. You have to maintain this polarity. You cannot leave this minus sign. Include this minus sign and write it. So input will be minus 2 volts. Output is 10.2 volts, plus 10.2 volts. And what about this time? Where will you fix this time? Time t is equal to 5 milliseconds. So this data is given for the range of integration. See, we have an integration there, is it not, in the expression? So the we have to integrate the input from time t is equal to 0 to time t is equal to 5, because we have applied the input at time t is equal to 0 and we have received the, we have got the output at time t is equal to 5. So it means the entire operation is done from time t is equal to 0 to time t is equal to 5. So integration limit will be 0 to 5. So all the data have been given in the question. The only unknown will be the time constant. So substitute that and get an output for R1C. You will not get individual values of R and C. Together as a time constant, R1C value you can obtain from this. Is completed. Shall I show the solution for this? Right, so your final time constant R1C is equal to 0.862 milliseconds. See, the expression is written, we have substituted for Vx, we have substituted for input Vs, integration is from 0 to 5, Vs is 2 also, not minus 2, that has been taken as a constant outside. Now integration of dt is t, apply the limits, upper limit minus lower limit, your value will be 0.862 milliseconds, okay. Now next is differentiator. When the inverting input terminal resistor of an op-amp inverter circuit is replaced by a capacitor, right? See, what is the change here in differentiator? In a differentiator, the input resistance is replaced with a capacitance, right? You, instead of a resistor, I've used a capacitor on the input side, and the feedback remains the same resistor, okay? So this is again, like, it looks like an inverting amplifier where the input resistor is replaced by a capacitor, okay? For a integrator, feedback resistor is replaced by a capacitor. For a differentiator, input resistor is replaced by a capacitor, okay? So now again, the usual thing, you have to use the golden rules of op-amp. Just make a try. I hope you can understand what has been shown here. Make a try. Try to find out what will be the expression for the output. Same way you have to write the expression. You have to write nodal equation for this node, which will be equal to zero. Okay. So Is this current, and then I2 this current, and In all whole everything is equal to zero. In we know, it is always equal to zero because no current will enter into the op-amp. That is one of the golden rules, that no current will enter into the op-amp, and therefore this is zero. So this current plus this current is equal to zero. Okay, so find out what is the value of this current. Okay, write the current through the capacitor equation. Further, the voltage will be, this side it is Vs, this side it is zero. Okay, so Vs minus zero will be that. So C into dVs by dt will be the current through this. Is it not? C is equal to dVs by dt. dVs minus 0, so it is dVs by dt. Similarly, write the expression for current through this resistor. It is I2 into, sorry, the current here is V2 0 minus V0 divided by R2. It is V0 by R2. That will be the current I2. Okay, current I2 is V0 by R2. Okay, this current and this current both are equal, is it not? Because this current is equal to zero, means the entire current will flow through the capacitor, the same current will flow through the resistor also. And therefore, this current expression and this current expression should be equated so that you will get an expression for output. Okay, so output will, it will be differentiation of input. V0 will be equal to R1C, R2C into dVs by dt. Okay, it will be V0 is equal to minus R2C into dVs by dt. Okay, why is we are getting this minus sign? We know because we are providing the input to the inverting terminal. Okay, so this is for differentiator, and application may, this also be discussed. Mainly differentiator is used for edge detection. That is, when I give a square input to a differentiator, my output will be spikes. The spikes will be whenever there is a change in the input from high value to a low value, or from a low value to high value. During the edges, the spikes will be generated. Okay. And apart from that, of course, you can use it for other applications also. As I said, this can be used as a high pass filter in a wave shaping circuits for generating pulses, narrow pulses. Timing circuits, it's not given here. Even in timing circuits, we can use, is it not? Because after a particular period of time, to intimate that, you can have a spike generated over there. Okay, so in timing circuits, we can use. So like that, we have many applications for differentiator also, and even PID controller, which you'd have learned in control system. Okay. Now we'll see an example here. You have seen what is the expression for, output expression for a differentiator, right? Now go through this problem. See what is the problem given. Determine the output voltage of a differentiator circuit assume that the input voltage Vi is equal to 3.5 cos 100 pi t, and the time constant is, now this time constant they have given, R2 C1 is equal to 1.5 millisecond. Input is given. What are you supposed to find? Output. Direct expression. Write the expression for output. Substitute the input as 3.5 cos 100 pi t. Substitute the time constant value as 1.5 milliseconds. Find out what is the output for this. This, I'll give you time, a 1 minute time for this. Try to solve this and get an expression, get an output for this one. This direct substitution. So make a try. Make a try. Once you complete, I'll let you know the solution for this. Just write the voltage, output voltage equation of a differentiator. Substitute the time constant. Substitute the input. Minus R2 C1 into dVs by dt. That is the expression, is it not? So differentiate this 3.5 cos 100 pi t. Differentiate that properly and get an output expression, output value for this. Make a try. These are direct substitution problems. Okay. Yes, let me show the solution for this. Check out your solution. Expression, substituted, differentiate, differentiate properly. Cos 100 pi t will be sine 100 pi t into 100. Of course, cos, differentiation of cos is minus sine, so you'll have a minus sine also here. So your output will be 1.65 sine 100 pi t. Getting it? All are getting this answer? Direct substitution, is it not? Okay. Right, we'll move on to the next one. Now, we are going to see few more problems with the concepts, what we have learned till now. So what are the concepts we have learned? See, everything has been brought into a single slide. Inverting amplifier means the gain will be minus R2 by R1. Okay, you have to remember this for doing the problems. Okay, inverting amplifier means what will be the gain? Minus R2 by R1. Non-inverting amplifier means 1 plus R2 by R1. Good. Then for a summing amplifier, inverting summing amplifier, it will be minus Rf into first input by R1 plus second input by R2 plus third input by R3. This will go on if you have any number of inputs. Okay. And then differentiator integrator. Differentiator, it is V0 will be equal to minus R2 C1 to dV1 by dt. Just now we saw. And for an integrator, this is the output. If you have some initial charge, then it will look like this. Okay, or you will have an initial charge minus this one. Okay, the charge in the capacitor. Right? So just remember these things. We are going to do problems now. Okay, take down the first problem. See, now this is not a single circuit. You can see a series of circuits given here, series of op-amps connected as a circuit. Now we have to, what is the question given? Calculate the input voltage if the final output is C. Usually, input will be given, they will be asking the output of a given circuit. Now it is reverse, output is given, and we need to find the input of the circuit. Right? So first go through the circuit, try to identify the circuit and tell me in which way we can find the input now. They are not asking output, it is input is asked. So first go through the circuit, identify what are the circuits given here. Yes, got an idea now. So let's see. See, first I said no, always when a circuit is given, you have to identify what type of circuit is this. You are here, we have three op amps, op amp 1, 2, and 3. So now we are going to identify what is this circuit, what is this, and what is this, right? So just by seeing, you can see that input is given to the non-inverting terminal and inverting terminal is grounded, you have a feedback. So what circuit is this must be? This is must be a non-inverting amplifier. Am I right? So this is a non-inverting amplifier. Now similarly, what is this circuit? Now input is given to the inverting terminal. Non-inverting is grounded and you have a feedback. So this must be a inverting amplifier, right? And similarly, what about here? One input is given to the inverting terminal, non-inverting grounded. So again, this is also an inverting amplifier, right? So you have a non-inverting amplifier, inverting amplifier, and here inverting amplifier. Right, so we have identified the circuit, we know what is the expression for inverting and non-inverting amplifier. Now we have to find out what is the required data. Required parameter is the input value, what is given is the output value, right? So you have to go in the reverse way. So first let us take this last one, because here only we know a value, right? So let us take this inverting amplifier, write the expression for inverting amplifier. Okay, substitute V0 value to be 10.08. Resistor values have been given here, is it not? And therefore, you can easily identify what is the only unknown input. The input what comes here. Okay, see, remember, the output of the first circuit is the input for the second one. The output of the second circuit is the input of the third one. So if you are finding the input of the third one, it means it is the output of the second one, right? So now we are trying to find the input of the third one using the inverting amplifier expression. So it is very simple, just make a try. What is the expression just now we saw for an inverting amplifier? It is minus R2 by R1. R2 value is 100k and R1 value is 5k. Okay, gain is nothing but output by input. So V0 by VI is equal to 100 divided by 5, where V0 value is 10.08, and therefore you can find out what is VI. Do it, find out the input to the third stage. Yeah, how much you are getting? See, we are going to consider this as VA and this is VB. Right? So we are going to work backwards. So minus 100 by 5 into VB. How much is VB? VB is nothing but the input of the third part, which is nothing but the output of the second part, whose value is minus 0.504 volts. So now we have obtained VB. Now VB is known, this resistor is known, this resistor is known. So try to find VA by writing the expression of this middle circuit. The middle circuit is again a inverting amplified circuit. Again, same expression, minus R2 by R1 into input. So output VB is equal to minus R2 by R1 into VA. So VB is known, R2, R1, everything is known, only unknown is VA. So try to find out VA from this. Try to find out VA from this one. We have found VB, which is the input of the third amplifier, which is input of the third circuit. And now we have to find VA. So how will you get? Right? So it is very simple, right? VB is equal, because both the resistor values are equal, minus 5 by 5 into VA, and therefore VA is also plus 0.504. This is minus 0.504. This is plus 0.504. See, this is basically, just think, this is an inverting amplifier, okay? So it will not do a bigger operation and all. Just it has to invert the input with a gain factor, okay? So since the gain factor is 1 here, therefore the output and input are same. Next, do the same thing for non-inverting amplifier. See here, it is not inverting, it is non-inverting. So gain equation changes, which is 1 plus R2 by R1. Again, R2 value is given, R1 value is given. We know what is VA, so from that we can find out what is V1. So write the expression for this non-inverting amplifier. Yes, getting this answer. So finally, V1 is equal to 0.168 volt. Any doubt in this? Go through the problem. Any doubt in this? Have you understood? Getting this answer, 0.168 volts. Okay, next. Now, similar way you have to do this problem also. Copy down the circuit. First, identify what type of circuit is this. And then we'll see how to solve this. Here, output is asked by giving the inputs. Input values have been given as 700 millivolts, both V1 and V2. And we need to find out what are the overall output of the circuit. Okay. Yes. So what circuit is this? Again, non-inverting terminal is grounded, inverting terminal, you have applied the input, you have a feedback. So obviously this must be a inverting amplifier circuit. Okay. Now what about this second part? Non-inverting is grounded, input is given to the inverting amplifier, but not a single input. Okay, V2 is going here. At the same time, the output of the first one is also applied as the input to the second one. Okay, so two inputs are provided to this second op-amp. So what circuit must be this? Whenever you have multiple inputs to the same terminal of an op-amp, then it means it is a summing amplifier. Okay, so it will act as an adder. So here also I have two inputs given to the inverting terminal of the op-amp, and therefore this will be an inverting adder. Right, so we have identified what circuits are this, right? Now try to write the expression for this and find out the output. Okay, you need not go in the reverse and I'll go in this order itself. First write the equation for inverting amplifier, substitute the values, find out the output. Then write the equations for summing amplifier, substitute the values and get the output. That will be your final output. Make a try. Very simple circuit. Substitute the inputs as 700 millivolts. The first part, we are identifying what is VA, that is the output of the inverting amplifier, which is minus 1.4 volts. Getting it? It is minus 1.4 volts. Remember, input is in millivolts, okay? And the resistor values are in kilo ohms. So use the units properly, and therefore you will get it as minus 1.4 volts as the output of the first part of the circuit. And next one, summing amplifier. The expression is minus RF into first input divided by the corresponding resistor plus second input divided by the corresponding resistor. And therefore, it comes to both inputs are 700 millivolts. No? So, and therefore, it comes to 0 volts. Yes, this is 0 volts. Because the first input, which is VA, we have found as minus 1.4 volts. So minus 1.4 volts divided by 100 plus V2 by 50. V2 is 700 millivolts, which is 0.7. So 1.4 by 100 and this is 0.7 by 50. Both the values are same, and this is a negative number and this is a positive number, and therefore it comes to 0. So 0 into anything, the entire value will become 0. So the overall output of this is 0 volts. Getting it? Hope everybody is doing and you're getting the answers. Okay. Right. So this is 0 volts, the final answer. Okay. Now, okay, we are going in for a new type of application of op-amp. Okay, till now we were learning closed loop applications of op-amp, like whether it is a summing amplifier or instrumentation amplifier or differential amplifier, in differentiator, integrator, whatever it is a closed loop amplifier. Okay, it is your op-amp is configured in closed loop. Closed loop means you will have a feedback from the output to the input. Okay, now we are going to see an application for open loop configuration of op-amp. It means here we not have a feedback from output to input. Okay. So what is the comparator? From the name itself, we can understand that comparator means it will compare something, right? And we know that whenever you want to compare certain things, you need a reference for comparison. Only with the reference we'll be comparing and saying this is not that very good as that one. This is excellent when compared to this, like that. Where you can do the comparison only when there is a reference parameter. Okay, the same thing holds good here also. Here op-amp is used in open loop mode configuration, and you'll be comparing an unknown voltage with a known DC reference voltage. Okay, so unknown voltage will be always compared with a known voltage. Okay, and you have two types of comparators here, non-inverting comparator and inverting comparator. Non-inverting comparator, see how the circuit looks like. Non-inverting comparator, the unknown for which we want to do the comparison, okay, that unknown will be given in the non-inverting terminal for a non-inverting comparator. Okay, so whatever comparator we are using, inverting or non-inverting, based on that input will be given. So the unknown input is given to the non-inverting terminal of the op-amp, and the reference voltage, I said, no, we will be comparing with the DC reference. That reference is given to the other terminal, which is an inverting terminal. Okay, so unknown non-inverting terminal and known reference to a inverting terminal of the op-amp. Okay, what about the output? See, you don't have any feedback and all here. Can you see that? There's no feedback here. So since there is no feedback, what an op-amp will do? The op-amp will always see what is the how an op-amp works. The op-amp is basically an amplifier. It will amplify the differential input because it has two inputs. Always it will find what is the difference between the two inputs, and that will get amplified, right? So when I have two inputs V1 and V2, the difference between this V1 minus V2 will get amplified by the gain of the op-amp, right? When you put a closed loop, the gain of the op-amp is reduced by the negative feedback, and we know what will be the gain expression for different circuits. Since we don't have a feedback here from the output to the input, the gain of the op-amp is the ideal gain, which will be very high. Okay, ideally speaking, the open loop gain of an op-amp is infinite. Okay, but practically it will be very high, in the order of 10 past 6. So what will happen? V1 minus V2 will get multiplied by such a high gain. So what will be the output then? Will you get such a high value at the output, 10 past 6 into some difference between this? You cannot. It's not for any circuit. Your maximum voltage swing can be between the DC supply what we are giving, the biasing value what you are giving, right? The biasing voltage is plus or minus 15 volts for this op-amp IC741. Okay, plus or minus 15 means maximum it can swing up to plus 15 and minus 15. So it means when V1 minus V2, this difference is a positive voltage, means the positive maximum at the output will be plus 15 volts, that is plus Vsat. We call it as the saturation voltage. Okay? It gets, your output gets saturated to the biasing voltage. Okay, so it will get saturated to plus 15 volts. Similarly, V1 minus V2, if it is a negative value, okay, it means that V2 is greater than V1. Right? In that case, your output should be a negative value, a maximum negative value, but again, it will get saturated to minus 15. So it means for a comparator, the output can be either plus 15 or minus 15, or in general, we can say plus Vsat and minus Vsat. Okay, so suppose if your supply voltage is only plus or minus 12 volts, then it will be swinging between plus 12 and minus 12, is it not? So generally, we'll call this as it will be swinging between plus Vsat and minus Vsat. Okay, so let's see the waveforms for that. See, when input is greater than V reference, what is Vn? We'll go back to the circuit. This is Vn. Vn is given to the positive one. So when Vn is greater than V reference, it means positive is greater than this negative, then your output will go to plus Vsat, right? So when Vn, this is your Vn, okay, the sinusoidal signal, and this is your reference voltage, DC voltage is your reference. So when Vn is greater than V reference, this part, okay, during this part, when it is greater than V reference, then your output will be at plus Vsat. When Vn is less than V reference, it means this is less and this is greater. If this is greater, minus is greater. A negative voltage is greater. So the difference between that will be a negative value, and therefore your output will go to minus Vsat. So when Vn is less than this, V reference, this is a V reference, less than this means this part, this entire part, everywhere it is less than V reference, then all these values, the output will be at minus Vsat. Clear? Vn greater than V reference means difference is positive, and therefore output will go to plus Vsat. When Vn is less than V reference, the difference is negative, and therefore your output will go to minus Vsat. So that is what shown as the graph here. Hope you understood this, right? Any doubt in this comparator? Of course, this is a application where op-amp is used in open loop configuration. Hope you understand this. Is it not? Okay. Similarly, what we saw is a non-inverting comparator, because your unknown voltage was given to the non-inverting terminal. Now this is inverting comparator. It means the unknown voltage is given to the inverting terminal of the op-amp. Okay, and again no feedback, same concept. Now can you tell me how this comparator will work, when it will go to plus Vsat and when it will go to minus Vsat, right? Of course, when Vin is less than V reference, your Vd is positive, and therefore your output will go to plus Vsat. Same thing, when Vn is greater than V reference, the difference between the two input, it becomes negative, and therefore what will happen to the output? Output will go to minus V saturation. Okay, the same thing is shown in the graph.
you can compare the table with the graph whenever your Vn is nothing but the sinusoidal signal, the AC signal what is applied, and V reference is a DC voltage. Okay, so whenever Vn is less than V reference, okay, that is the below part and all, okay, below this line, this dashed line, in all these cases the difference becomes positive and therefore the output will be at plus V set, and Vn is greater than V reference, vice versa will happen. Okay, so this is inverting comparator. So we have seen non-inverting comparator and inverting comparator. Okay, any doubt in this? Right, now next one, very important one, the last topic for us today, skimmit trigger. Okay, skimmit trigger, you have to understand this properly. So first take the circuit of the skimmit trigger, which is otherwise called as regenerative comparator, a circuit with positive feedback. Again, we have not come across any circuit like this where you'll be having a positive feedback. Or for all the circuits, you'll be having the feedback from the output to the inverting terminal of the op-amp. But here, if you see, it is to the non-inverting terminal of the op-amp. Output is fed back to the non-inverting terminal of the op-amp. Okay. Right. Now, how the skimmit trigger will work? Okay. Since it is a comparator, we call this as a regenerative comparator. The output will be either at plus Vsat or at minus Vsat. Okay, based on the output, whether it is plus or minus Vsat, you'll be having a difference in the threshold that is going to this, the reference voltage. See, the threshold is nothing but the reference voltage. The unknown value is again given to the inverting terminal, and you have to give a reference voltage to the other terminal, is it not? That reference voltage is fed back from the output to the input. Okay, so you are getting a reference voltage from the output to the non-inverting terminal of the input. Okay, since your output is not constant, it shifts between plus Vsat and minus Vsat. Okay, it swings between plus Vsat and minus Vsat. The reference voltage also will be shifting between a positive reference voltage and a negative reference voltage. So you don't have a constant reference voltage here. See, in the previous circuit, and whether it is inverting comparator or non-inverting comparator, your reference voltage is always fixed. Okay, a fixed DC voltage, either a positive DC voltage or a negative DC voltage, as you wish. Even you can make a change there. See, in the examples, what we have shown only a positive reference voltage. Even you can have a negative reference voltage. Okay, so based on your reference voltage, your waveform will be obtained, your output waveform will be different, right? But here you don't have a constant voltage, you have two different voltages changing based on the output, because your reference voltage is from the output. Since output changes, the input also shifts between positive and negative reference. Okay, now let us assume that initially, my V naught is at plus V saturation, that is plus 15 volts. Okay, and what will happen? This is a voltage divider circuit. You have an output voltage here. A part of the output voltage is fed back. So V naught into R1 divided by R1 plus R2. So the voltage what you have here, it will get dropped here. The remaining voltage will be available across the resistor R1. That voltage, it is fed as the input. So your V plus will be equal to a part of the output voltage, which is a positive voltage that is applied here. So your unknown is compared with this V plus. Okay, now unknown is compared. Initially, let us take unknown is a lesser value than V plus. Say we'll take R1 and R2 to be equal. No, so it will be easy for understanding. If R1 and R2 is equal and my output saturation is 15 volts, then what will be the reference here? 7.5, is it not? Because 15 into R1 divided by R1 plus R2, R1 plus R2 both are same, so it is 2R1. So 15 divided by 2 you'll get, which will be equal to 7.5 volts, right? So VI is compared with 7.5. So initially, let us take VI is at 0. VI is a sinusoidal signal, okay? So VI is a sinusoidal signal like this, right? And you have a reference voltage which is 7.5 volts as the reference. Say 7.5 is somewhere here, okay? So this is my reference voltage, okay? VR. Now initially when my input is less than this VR, this part, okay? So this part input, this is less and this is greater. So what will happen? This is less, Vin only is greater, okay? And therefore your output will remain in the same plus Vsat and your reference voltage will be same 7.5 volts, okay? And your output will be plus Vsat. It means it will be a positive voltage during this period, okay? It will be a positive voltage. Now when your input crosses this reference, okay? When your input is greater than the reference, that is when this input is greater than 7.5 volts, what will happen? Negative voltage is higher now, okay? If negative voltage is higher, your output will go to minus V saturation, okay? So it means your output goes to a negative value now, right? When output, so till now your output was positive, now your output will go to negative, okay? When your output goes to negative value, what happens to the reference voltage? What you have calculated here? Minus 15 volts into R1 divided by R1 plus R2. Now, so the reference voltage changes to minus 7.5 volts. Okay, so now minus 7.5 volts is coming here as the reference. Now what will happen? Input is compared with minus 7.5 volts. Okay, so after this period, okay, once the input crosses this, my reference is not this one, my reference is this. Okay, minus 7.5. So when you compare minus 7.5 and this positive voltage, of course positive only is greater, it means inverting terminal is greater and therefore your output will remain in this minus Vsat itself. Output will be in minus Vsat itself till your input goes and come back and it reaches this minus 7.5. Throughout this journey, your unknown input is greater than the reference voltage because now the reference voltage is minus 7.5, not plus 7.5. Okay, so in all these cases, it is greater than the reference voltage. Okay, and therefore output will remain in minus V saturation itself. Now, once your input crosses minus 7.5, okay, what will happen? Once it crosses minus 7.5, it means it becomes lesser than minus 7.5. So when this is less than this, positive input becomes greater, positive terminal becomes greater, and therefore your output shifts to plus Vsat. So now your output will shift to plus Vsat. Output shifts, okay, I'm writing here. Output shifts to minus V, plus Vsat, okay? So now your reference is plus Vsat means again your part of the output comes as the reference. So your reference changes from minus 7.5 volts to plus 7.5 volts. Okay. Now, throughout this region, okay, 7.5 is compared with input. Now, input is negative value till it reaches the 7.5. Throughout the region, my output is positive. So what happens when you'll have a shift in the output is whenever your input is greater than the positive reference and lesser than the negative reference, only in these two cases you will be having shift in the output either from plus Vsat to minus Vsat or from minus Vsat to plus Vsat. Okay, in between this, when your input is lesser than that or your input is greater than this negative voltage, in those two cases you will not have any change in the output. Output will remain the same as in the previous state. If it was already in positive state, it will remain in the positive state itself. If it is a negative state, it will remain in the negative state. There will not be any change in between. So that period we call it as the hysteresis period. Okay. You will have two thresholds here, positive V reference and negative V reference. In between these two reference voltages, you will not have any change in the output, and therefore that period is called as hysteresis. That we'll see. See, this is what your output will go from plus Vsat to minus Vsat. Okay, And when your input is reduced, it will go from minus Vsat to plus Vsat. And in between, you have a period here. No, this period is called as hysteresis period. Okay, where you will not have any change in the output. Your output will remain the same. Okay, so when Vin is greater than V positive and Vin is less than V negative, only in these two cases we'll be having. See, in this case and in this case, only in these two cases you'll be having shift in the output. Okay, in the other case, that is when Vin is less than V positive or Vin is greater than V negative, in those two cases the output will remain in the previous state itself. Okay, so it will that is the advantage of this regenerative comparator, and therefore even when there is any noise added to the input signal, that will not create any change in the output. Okay, because in the previous comparator, the usual comparator, that is inverting and non-inverting comparator, whenever a noise is added to the input signal, that will create a change. Okay, because it just compares the reference voltage with the unknown. When input is greater than reference, you will have a output. When input is less than a reference, you will have an output. So when some noise is added to the input signal, there are chances that your output may shift because of the noise. Okay, you may have a transition because of the noise. So that is avoided here in this regenerative comparator, which is otherwise called a scimitricon. Clear? This is a very important concept. Hope you have understood. Right? Just see it once, 1 minute time. Understand, because we are going to do a problem here. Just see the expressions what we have written here. You need to identify when it will shift from one output state to the other output state. Because you have only two output states here, is it not? Positive saturation and negative saturation. So when it will switch from positive to negative or negative to positive. So when this transition will occur, at what time? Okay. Just see it once so that we'll move to the problem. Yes. Okay, now take down the problem. See the problem. Both solution is also given here. Assume that for a scimitricon circuit shown at the left, V positive by V negative is plus or minus 12 volts. It means the saturation voltage is, okay, saturation voltage is not 15, plus or minus 12 volts. R1 is equal to R2. So when both the resistors are equal, that is what easy for us. When both the resistors are equal, half of the output will get will go as a reference voltage here. So if this is 12 volts, means half of that is 6 volts. Okay. So 6 volts will, plus or minus 6 volts will be the reference. Okay. Plus 6 volts when output is positive 12 volts. Minus 6 volts when your output is negative 12 volts. Okay. R1, R2, and Vin is a 10 volts peak triangular signal. Okay. Vin input is a triangular signal. It is not a sinusoidal signal. It is a triangular signal. Peak voltage is 10 volts. Okay. It is not peak to peak. Peak voltage is 10 volts. Okay. So RMS value is 10 volts. What is the resulting output waveform? You are supposed to draw the output waveform. Okay. Please don't see this. Okay, just try to understand the question and try to draw the waveform. See, what are the things you have to consider here? You have to know when the switching will occur. That is during your reference voltage. As I said, reference voltage will be plus or minus 6 volts. Okay, since your output is plus or minus 12 volts, so we have to draw the output waveform. So output waveform will be between plus 12 volts and minus 12 volts. See, this is the input they have drawn, a triangular waveform between plus 10 and minus 10. Output will be between plus 12 and minus 12. Only thing is, you should know when it should be plus 12, when it should be minus 12, when the transition is occurring. So for that, understand this scimitricon circuit. Go with the logic how it works. Based on that, you can draw the output, is it not? What you have to do? Plus 6, when output is plus 12 volts, your reference voltage will be plus 6. when it is plus 6 and your input is less than 6, what will happen? When this is less, input less than 6 volts. So this is only greater, so your output will remain in the same plus 12 volts. Okay. So for all lower regions, okay, that is when your input, this dashed line is less than 10, so less than 6. Okay. So let us take this as 6 volts. Okay. Half of your output voltage, positive reference. So this is 6 volts. So when your input is less than 6, your output will be in plus Vsat. When your input crosses 6, what will happen? Input greater than 6. So minus is greater and therefore output shifts to minus Vsat region, which is minus 12 volts. It goes to minus 12 volts, right? And how long it will remain in minus 12 volts? This minus 6 is here. My input, if you see, right, my once your output switches to minus 12 volts, immediately the reference voltage becomes minus 6 now. So now this is your reference voltage, okay? Now compare the input. Input is still positive because from here till here only we have come. Input is still positive. So positive compared with a negative minus 6 volts. So this is only greater and therefore your output will remain in the same minus V saturation until your input becomes greater than the negative saturation. So your negative saturation minus 6. When your input crosses this minus 6, when it is less than minus 6, say minus 7, minus 8 volts, what happens? This becomes greater, positive voltage. This minus 6 volts is greater than this. And therefore your output switches to, when this crosses, immediately your output switches to plus V saturation. And therefore your reference also changes to, reference now changes to plus 6 volts. Now plus 6 volts is compared with Vin. And where is Vin? Vin has just crossed here. Okay, now your reference is here. So your input is less than the reference. Input less than the reference means output will remain in the same V plus, V saturation. Okay, so like this only you will be drawing the waveform for this. Clear? Understood? Okay, so till now, what are the topics we have seen? We started with differentiator, integrator, problems related to differentiator, integrator. Then we started with comparators, inverting, non-inverting comparator, and then schemat trigger. And we did problems based on all the applications of op-amp, whatever we have seen till now. Okay, so that's it with the concepts of op-amps, applications of op-amp. So in the next class, we'll be doing only problems. Okay, now we saw all the concept and then problem, is it not? Next class, we'll be seeing only problems because time up now, we'll not proceed after this. Okay, so we'll move on with problems, gate problems specifically in next class, right? Any doubts? Have you understood whatever we have seen today? Okay, students, thanks for your cooperation. We'll be meeting in the next class. Be ready for doing the problems. Thank you.